Shell Gaon. At 8:10, who said crime travel never pays?
I use the machine to go back. I tell you the numbers, you place the bet, and you collect the money.
At 9, a new thriller drama starring Patrick Dempsey.
It was an accident, Harrison.
It was murder.
Saturday night on BBC One.
Sam is convinced that the police are pursuing the wrong murder suspect, but will anyone listen to her arguments? Silent witness at 10 o'clock. First, the 9 o'clock news and campaign report on BBC One with Michael Buerk.
The Conservatives have been on the defensive over Europe. John Major's refused to sack Angela Browning, the minister at the centre of a row over single currency. Essex firefighters have voted to strike over spending cuts. And the Navy strikes its flag in Hong Kong as the sun finally sets on Empire. Good evening. Europe has been at the centre of the election campaign today, with the Prime Minister defending Angela Browning, the junior agriculture minister, accused of repudiating the government's line on the single currency. In an election leaflet, Mrs. Browning said she was opposed to transferring any British gold and currency reserves to a new European bank. That, according to the Maastricht Treaty, is a requirement for joining the single currency. The opposition parties said she had broken ranks over the government's wait-and-see policy on the issue. John Major said she hadn't. Our political editor Robin Oakley reports.
In Norwich today, the Prime Minister encountered his most raucous reception yet. And a day which was supposed to have been spent ambushing Labour's business manifesto launch instead had to be turned to damage limitation as the Tory tensions on Europe were exposed. The long-expected problem came in the unexpected shape of Junior Agriculture Minister Angela Browning and her stance on the single European currency.
Wait and see.
That's what ministers are supposed to do on the single currency. But in an election newsletter, she'd warned that countries which joined would have to hand over gold and currency reserves to a European central bank. And she added, "This is the end of sovereignty of the nation state, and if that is what is offered, I will not support it." But Mrs. Browning insisted she backed government policy and was free to speak out.
"We are quite happy to have open debate on this, and I think that's a very healthy and democratic thing. We're not some Stalinist party like New Labour."
What would you say to the fact that Labour and the Liberal Democrats have called for your resignation?
"Oh, I know they have. Of course they want me to resign. They hate me at the dispatch box. I give them a very hard time."
Shadow ministers are insisting that Labour opponents of a single currency won't be seen expressing their reservations. They called a special news conference to exploit Tory disunity.
"The chronic divisions in the Conservative Party over Europe mean they cannot defend British interests. They are now a disorganised rabble, breaking apart with dozens of separate manifestos, factions pushing and financing specific anti-European positions, and even government ministers at odds with the official manifesto line."
They demanded Mr. Major should sack Mrs. Browning.
"The Tory Central Office, to pretend that this pledge is in line with government policy, is to pile a flat lie on top of an open split. John Major must finally show a spark of leadership."
The Liberal Democrat leader took time out on the campaign trail to echo that call.
"Angela Browning is clearly breaking the Conservatives' policy pledges, and if the Prime Minister had any strength of leadership, he'd get rid of her. The truth of the matter is, the bottom line truth is this: whatever your wish, whatever your view on Europe, Britain's best interests cannot now any longer be represented by a party that's divided and at war with itself."
But at his news conference, a cheery Mr. Major, swapping rapid one-liners with the press corps, resisted all suggestions that Mrs. Browning had done anything wrong, while warning other ministers to stay in line.
"I expect ministers to support the Conservative manifesto and to make it clear that they're supporting the manifesto. And I believe you're going to find that that's what ministers are going to do."
He sought to run the controversy into the sands, saying that much detail still remained to be negotiated.
"Questions of reserves and other matters, still a great deal of negotiating to be done. I mean, I think there is a great deal of misunderstanding about how far we have got and what is actually going to happen in those negotiations."
This is disputed by his opponents, and a Maastricht Treaty protocol is clear. It says, the European Central Bank shall be provided by the national central banks with foreign reserve assets. It goes on, the European Central Bank shall have the full right to hold and manage the foreign reserves transferred to it. But it's still uncertain what proportion of our gold and currency reserves would have to be moved. And the Bank of England confirmed today that member states would be able to ask for their money back when they wanted.
If you'd like to meet Peter Tapsell, please come to your door.
But for many Tories, it isn't the detail which matters. They're campaigning simply to save the pound. Already some senior Eurosceptics have produced election addresses insisting they'll vote against any proposal that Britain should join a single currency.
Any country that gives up its own currency ceases to be an independent nation state, and I therefore will never vote for Britain to join a single European currency.
As many as 150 more are predicted to join them. Mr. Major and his party managers are making a virtue of necessity, saying they're leaving candidates free to make their personal views plain, while Labour are imposing an iron control on known rebels. But they'll be holding their breath that dissidents don't include any more ministers choosing to be more specific than Mrs. Browning. It's been made clear it'll be a sackable offence if they do. Robin Oakley, BBC News, Westminster.
Tony Blair today described Labour as the entrepreneur's champion. The Labour leader was speaking at the launch of the party's manifesto for business. The Conservatives warned against Labour's plans to sign up to the European Social Chapter, and the Liberal Democrats said Labour's proposals were warm words with no commitment. Our business correspondent Greg Wood reports.
Famous names from the world of business, like Sir Terence Conran and Jerry Robinson, chairman of Granada, were on show at the launch of Labour's business manifesto. The party said its aim was to go beyond reassurance and persuade business that Labour was a better prospect than the Conservatives.
Now, I don't say that everyone in the business community is all coming over to Labour, but I do say two things. One, that we have a lot of support now amongst the business community in a way that was unthinkable a few years ago. But secondly, even those business people that aren't supporting Labour now know they've got a Labour Party that supports enterprise, that supports business.
Later, it was time for a factory visit. Labour's business manifesto has many policies in common with the Conservatives. For example, Labour has promised to stick to existing spending targets for the next 2 years. It's also keen to promote greater private sector involvement in public sector projects like hospitals and roads.
What we see in this manifesto is confirmation of the shifts in Labour's policy that have occurred over the last few years towards a support for a market economy, and there's many features where they now have policies that we can agree with, and indeed which represent a significant degree of cross-party consensus. There are some specific policy areas where we have a different approach, I mean things like the social chapter and the minimum wage, but even in those they have taken some measures to mitigate some of the risks.
These are the areas of Labour's business policy which set it apart from the Conservatives. Labour is committed to signing the European Social Chapter. This would give workers in large companies the right to be represented by a works council. It would also confer a statutory right to parental leave. Labour is also committed to granting the right to recognition of unions, where a majority of the workforce is in favour. And Labour wants business rates to be set by local authorities, not, as at present, by central government. It's small businesses like this Indian restaurant which Labour is particularly anxious to win over. But here again it has problems, especially with its plans for a minimum wage. Labour says it'll be set at a sensible level. But in an economy where the service sector accounts for 80% of output, the minimum wage worries some businesses.
The choice is really between taking someone who is experienced and therefore we pay them the going rate, or allowing, if you like, the young, upcoming, enthusiastic people to join us and give them, if you like, a slightly lower rate of pay. But if they prove themselves, then we know that if we continue to abuse that, then they'll go somewhere else. So I feel that the minimum wage would destroy that.
The Conservatives regard the support of the business community as theirs almost by right. But today, Labour planted its standard in the heart of its opponent's territory. Greg Wood, BBC News.
Firefighters in Essex have voted to strike in protest at a county council decision to cut the fire service budget by £1.5 million. The union said it regretted the decision, but claimed that underfunding was endangering firefighters and the public. The Conservatives condemned the strike. Labour described it as unjustified and called for arbitration. Industry correspondent John Fryer reports.
25 green goddesses were lumbering into position even before the widely predicted vote to strike. The emergency army appliances will be ready for action during two 24-hour stoppages, the first a week tomorrow. The Essex firefighters are striking over a cut of £1.5 million in the brigade's budget, which they blame on underfunding from central government. 52 jobs are threatened.
Our people are saying enough is enough. It's not a strike about selfishness, about their own jobs, it's not about pay, it's about jobs going through natural wastage. But it means the erosion of fire cover to an extent that our people, who are the professionals, are saying is dangerous.
The firefighters have inevitably found themselves drawn into the general election campaign. The Tories say this is exactly the sort of dispute which has prompted their plan to make strikes harder in essential services.
This action should be condemned out of hand, which it is. It is exactly the sort of things that we have made so unusual in this country. We have the best industrial relations for 100 years, and as we get closer to a general election, as the unions begin to smell the payoff for the deal they've done with Tony Blair, you can begin to see them flexing their muscles.
But Labour says there were strikes elsewhere in the fire service before the election even started, and the Tories are just point scoring.
We do not believe that industrial action in this situation is justified. It is wrong for the people of Essex's safety to be put at risk. Moreover, there is a more sensible approach, namely arbitration, which has already been offered by the leader of Essex County Council.
A meeting with the union has been set for next week, but the council says firefighters haven't been treated any more harshly than other local government employees.
Labour says it will be tough on public spending and union power, but green goddesses will undoubtedly conjure up memories of old-fashioned public sector strikes, and that must surely be of more political benefit to the Tories than to Tony Blair. John Fryer, BBC News.
That's the news from the campaign trail for the moment. There'll be more later in the programme. But now the rest of the day's news. Eight men have gone on trial at the Old Bailey, accused of being part of an IRA plot to blow up electricity substations that would have caused months of disruption in London and the home counties. The men denied the charges. Home Affairs correspondent Graeme McLagan reports.
The trial started at the Old Bailey with high security. Armed police were on guard as a convoy arrived. Four of the eight defendants are from Ireland, three from Belfast and one from Birmingham. They all deny conspiracy to cause explosions likely to endanger life and damage property. 19 barristers plus solicitors are involved in this big trial. The prosecution said the case involved an IRA plan to blow up six large electricity substations surrounding London, providing the main power supplies from the national grid to the capital and parts of the southeast.
If the plot had succeeded, according to the prosecution, there'd have been serious and widespread loss of electricity. Supplies would have been affected for a considerable period of time and not back to normal for months or even more.
But the police made arrests in July last year at properties rented in false names in South London. At a flat in Woodbury Street, a mass of allegedly incriminating items was found, including maps of the national grid and notes on bombing. At another address, bomb-making equipment was found. The defendants had been under surveillance for months by MI5 and the police. One of the eight was said to have provided help and support, but the other seven were alleged to have formed the active service unit. Nigel Sweeney, prosecuting, said each had the use of up to four sets of false identity documents, and they had £24,000 in cash available. The first defendant, Donald Gannon, had been seen carrying out research on the electricity supply industry. Another, John Crawley, was said to have served with the United States Marines, specialising in explosives. The case continues next week with detailed evidence. The whole trial is expected to last about 2 months. Graeme McLagan, BBC News at the Old Bailey.
Iran's president, Ali Akbar Rafsanjani, has said Germany will suffer after a Berlin court accused him and the Iranian leadership of ordering the assassination of four Kurdish dissidents in 1992. Britain and other European states are recalling their senior diplomats from Iran.
Iran has been swift to threaten retaliation against Germany. Crowds rushed to the German embassy in Tehran, hurling insults and tomatoes. Their leaders said they'd do something more if Germany hadn't apologized by Monday. They surrounded the embassy with riot police and pushed the demonstrators back. Earlier at Friday prayers, Iran's President Rafsanjani, clutching a rifle, told the crowds that this was a passing storm and reminded them that past European sanctions against Iran had been short-lived. The crowd kept up their customary chants of death to Israel and death to America. But President Rafsanjani, who was implicated personally in the murders by the German court, said Germany would suffer and its interests would be hurt. Germany has a lot to lose. It's Iran's largest trading partner in the West. It had trade of around £1 billion last year, down considerably on previous totals, but Iran still owes Germany around £4.5 billion. Europe's sanctions will most likely include expelling known Iranian intelligence officers from the big embassies like the one in Bonn and diplomatic isolation. But they're unlikely to include the trade embargo urged by the United States.
We hope that the European Union will join the United States in a realistic policy that is aimed at containing Iran and containing its ability to further destabilize the Middle East and to murder its own citizens abroad.
Iran still has friends. Ali Akbar Natak Nouri, parliamentary speaker, and the man most likely to be elected president next month, was warmly received by President Yeltsin in the Kremlin today. The lesson from Germany, once an advocate of such contacts, is that few countries will take action against Iran until they have felt the effect of its policies. Brian Hanrahan, BBC News.
A showdown over trade with Cuba has been averted following a deal between the European Union and the United States. The agreement with American negotiators announced today comes after a year of bitter wrangling. The European Union had objected to American laws which threatened court action against foreign businesses trading in Cuba. India's 10-month-old coalition government has collapsed after the Prime Minister lost a vote of confidence. The country's political crisis started a fortnight ago when the Congress Party withdrew its support for the coalition. Mike Aldridge reports.
The vote that put pay to any lingering hopes Mr. Devigauda had of surviving the day.
Subject to correction, the result of the division is ayes 158, noes 292. The motion is negative.
Mr. Devigauda was a compromise Prime Minister when he was appointed 10 months ago. He chose a mixture of mockery and almost subdued defence of the government's record to challenge Congress, the coalition's friend turned foe. But one of his key allies could not contain his anger with Congress.
You are acting as destabilizers. You are acting as wreckers. That is why you will be taught the lesson ultimately by the people. I am sorry.
It's a party that already has the biggest single bloc in Parliament, the Hindu nationalist BJP, led by Atal Bihari Vajpayee, that could well stand to gain most from these events. An irony since Congress and the United Front formed their working partnership in the first place to keep the BJP out. After losing the confidence vote, Mr. Devigauda tendered his resignation to the President, who asked him to stay on as caretaker Prime Minister until alternative arrangements were made. The President's options range from offering others the chance to form a government to the calling of an election.
India's political crisis has only deepened now, and there can be no guarantee of even a fresh general election clearing the air. Even less can there be any certainty for Congress that bringing Mr. Devigauda down will help it in its attempt at achieving a political resurrection. Mike Aldridge, BBC News, Delhi.
The wife and the girlfriend of two British men taken hostage in Kashmir nearly 2 years ago are flying to the region to appeal for information about them. Keith Mangan and Paul Wells were seized by Kashmiri separatists. Last year, there were unconfirmed reports that they'd been killed.
It is almost 2 years since the two Britons disappeared into these mountains with a German and an American. They were seized by gunmen while camping in this hut The body of a Norwegian taken with them was found a month later. During the first 5 months of their captivity, their kidnappers released a stream of photographs along with threats, and there were constant sightings of the men wandering in the mountains. But since just before Christmas 1995, there have been no photos and no contact with their kidnappers, believed to be Islamic militants fighting for Kashmir to break away from India. The hostages were in the middle of a war, and the most likely reality is that they are now dead. When a leader of the kidnapped gang was arrested by chance, he said they'd been killed. But the families have refused to give up hope, clinging to rumours of more sightings.
There's been so many of them, and only one report, second-hand information report, that they were dead. And, I mean, can all them reports be untrue? I don't think so. I think some of them are true. And I'd like to get to the bottom of that.
They've been back for a short trip before, but this time the partners of the hostages are staying for a month, and they'll drop leaflets from a helicopter into the mountain passes. Enlisting the help of former Beirut hostages in their campaign, they remember that John McCarthy had been given up for dead before emerging alive after 5 years in jail. David Loyne, BBC News.
Here, an elderly woman who became ill in the outbreak of E. coli food poisoning in Scotland last December has died. She's not been named. Her death brings the total number of people killed in the outbreak to 19, making it the worst E. coli poisoning incident in Europe. The pay of chief executives in the National Health Service has risen by twice the rate of inflation, according to a report from Income Data Services. Their basic salaries went up by more than 6% to an average of £62,000 a year. A man's been killed and two other people were injured in an explosion at a factory in South London. It happened at the British Oxygen Company's gas cylinder plant at Merton. There's a growing north-south divide in the cost of houses, according to a survey by the Halifax Building Society. Prices in London, the South and the Midlands rose by up to 3% in the first quarter of this year. But in the north of England, Scotland and Wales, they fell. Economics correspondent Ed Crooks reports.
A year ago, most London estate agents' offices were quiet as the grave. Today, this one's almost frantic. After years of low mortgage rates and rising incomes, suddenly everyone's decided that now is the time to buy.
It's very hard to particularly understand why at one particular moment in the market things change so radically in such a short period of time, but that's the nature of the London market. It doesn't creep up, it tends to change very quickly and quite dramatically.
And in the more fashionable parts of London, the price rises have been truly spectacular. 3 or 4 years ago, an ordinary three-bedroom terrace house would have cost you about £200,000 in this part of West London. Today, those same houses are going for more like £300,000 or even £350,000. And in general this year, the biggest rises have been in Greater London, where prices are up on average 4.5%. In the South and the Midlands, they're also higher. But in Northern England, Scotland and Wales, they've been falling. And in Northern Ireland, they're down 3.5%. Estate agents in the north, like this one in Leeds, refuse to talk the market down. Prices haven't risen, but they say their business has picked up too.
In March, we had an all-time record month. Prices are not falling.
And a north-south divide?
Probably. I think there always will be, but I don't think it's widening.
In the 80s, the frenzy that began in London then spread, in a somewhat milder form, throughout the country. After the election, any government will have to beware leaving the door open to a repeat of that boom and subsequent bust. Ed Crooks, BBC News.
President Yeltsin has promised to resume funding for Russia's part of the International Space Station, easing fears of a further delay in the project. Russia is building two vital parts of the space station. Funding delays have already put back its first launch, due in November, by 6 months, raising fears in America that the whole £20 billion project could be put at risk. The White Ensign has been lowered for the last time at the British Naval Base in Hong Kong. The flag has flown in the colony for the past 150 years. As Fergal Keane reports, the ceremony is part of the preparations for Hong Kong's return to China this summer.
The Navy's longest patrol is over. On a hot Hong Kong morning, the sailors and Marines said goodbye to a century and a half of history. The Navy planted the first British flag in Hong Kong, Through conquest, defeat, war and peace, the naval station endured. But the age of the captains and kings has gone. There is no empire left to defend.
I very much hope that the legacy that we have left behind and the standards that we've set and so on will be with Hong Kong, and we shall remember our friends in Hong Kong for many, many, many years ahead.
The Navy's finest hour came at the end of the Second World War when its commanders accepted the Japanese surrender in Hong Kong, a compensation for the humiliation of defeat 4 years earlier.
Between now and the 30th of June, Britain's military presence in Hong Kong will be continuously and steadily wound down. By this time next year, most of this territory will be occupied by the People's Liberation Army. They are the new and emerging power in this region.
For locally recruited sailors like Petty Officer Ho, the closure of the base means unemployment. Would he consider joining the Chinese Navy?
I don't think so.
Why not?
I don't like the Chinese couple.
When you go? You go tomorrow night.
For pensioner Jenny Ung, who spent nearly 70 years cleaning British ships in Hong Kong, it was an emotional ceremony.
Very, very sad.
The bell was rung to mark the end of the final watch. And for the last time, the white ensign of the Navy came fluttering down under a Hong Kong sky. Fergal Keane, BBC News, Hong Kong.
The FA Cup semi-finals are being played on Sunday. Chesterfield from the lowly second division will take on Middlesbrough of the Premier League. For Chesterfield, never got this far before. They have a chance to become the first side ever from outside the top two divisions to reach the cup final.
Chesterfield has gone football crazy, football mad for the most successful FA Cup run in their 131-year history. And in a town which is a stranger to football glory, hopes are high of actually defeating star-studded Middlesbrough.
If we can cut Janino out, we've no problems.
After the way Chesterfield's played this season, I think they're going to lick them.
It's fantastic. Just for me, it's going to be a fantastic day out. It's going to be a carnival atmosphere.
Chesterfield, which cost just over £400,000 compared to the £25 million spent on Middlesbrough, beat Wrexham in the sixth round with this goal from Chris Beaumont after earlier victories against the likes of Bolton Wanderers and Nottingham Forest. Crowds flocked to a photo session earlier this week when the FA Cup came to town for a day. But will it be the Chesterfield team with their hands on the cup at Wembley in a month's time?
There's always a chance, isn't there? Underdog has a chance. It's a two-horse race. Strong favourites sometimes fall over, don't they? Unlikely, but we'll be given everything we've got.
And whatever happens on Sunday, there will be the customary specially recorded song to mark their FA Cup success this season. And in the town with the crooked spire, the song is even outselling the Spice Girls. Adam Minot, BBC News.
Coming up on tonight's 9 o'clock news, the gamble on the euro. We examine the arguments for and against Britain joining the European single currency. But first over to our political correspondent Anne Perkins at the Westminster campaign desk for her nightly election roundup.
Evening, Mike. Well, before the election was called, the parties were in hot pursuit of the black and Asian vote. The results and a number of marginals could hinge on which party most appeals to them. But many African Caribbean Britons remain reluctant to vote at all, partly because of a widespread view that politicians live on a different planet. Now their meetings have been set up in an attempt to prove them wrong.
A night out for members of the black community, which could decide which way they'll vote. One in four of the ethnic minority population is of African or Caribbean descent. Many say the campaign so far has been conducted as if the black voter doesn't exist. People here had hard questions to ask the platform.
I want to ask about fairness generally in the country. It has been quite a long time. People from the African origin have been subjected to unfairness in all sort of parameters, all sort of ways, at work, along the street, on the road, at home, everywhere.
My youngest qualified last year, graduated, and up to now he hasn't got a job yet.
My main interest is on immigration and the treatment of refugees.
Part of the challenge for politicians is to boost the black turnout, which tends to be low. Polls have suggested that amongst the under-25s, only 16% are certain to vote.
We have serious problem in terms of getting our people to participate in the political process in this country, because they strongly believe the political parties or the politicians don't in any way address the kind of issues that are of concern to them.
In the rush to woo Middle England, the black vote has been largely ignored by the parties. But although it's small on a national level, in a certain number of constituencies it could be the deciding factor. Events like this one are designed to remind politicians of that fact. Rita Chakrabarty, BBC News.
The referendum party has been given permission to challenge the decision by the BBC and commercial broadcasters to allow it just one party election broadcast. Lawyers at the High Court argued the party should have more airtime because it's contesting over 500 seats. There'll be a full hearing of the referendum party's case next Wednesday. The Natural Law Party has launched its manifesto, describing it as a blueprint for heaven on earth. It calls for government by natural law and a group of 7,000 yogic flyers to create a harmonious and coherent atmosphere through transcendental meditation, from which everyone could benefit.
We would very much recommend that anyone in responsibility does anything they can to make their brain functioning more coherent. I think it's quite evident, looking at the structure of leadership without becoming too personal, that this isn't always the case.
Paddy Ashton briefly visited the heartland of old liberalism today, North Wales, stopping off in the seat once represented by the last Liberal Prime Minister, Lloyd George.
Is that better?
But it's another Liberal Prime Minister, Gladstone, who's remembered in Penmen more, even though he only came here on his holidays. Paddy Ashton, always on the lookout for quality time with the voters, found a pensioner who could easily have known Lloyd George and who certainly fought in the First World War.
You know, yes, I remember firing at that ace German airman.
Richthofen.
Yes,
that's right.
Come along me.
Really? You remember him? The Red Baron?
Oh, yes. Remember him well.
Mr. Ashton was briefed with the only known Gladstone joke, told against the grand old man by his wife.
Oh, William, she said, if you were not such a great man, you would be a terrible bore. Which is a wonderful statement, isn't it?
A few hours and well over 100 miles later, Mr. Ashton was in Somerset.
Hello, my darling, how are you?
Wonderful return.
I haven't seen you for a minute. That's my wife, I think.
Back to the campaign, from Gladstone to Gladhanding. Grim news for traditionalists. Ballot boxes are changing. After countless years of functional tin, plastic is taking over. On May the 1st, the chances are your ballot box will look more like a piece of household equipment than the unmistakable old-fashioned black metal box. Not a lot has changed in the polling station in the last 50 years. The people who voted for Attlee almost certainly used the same ballot boxes as the people who voted for John Major.
There we go, look at that.
But now a whole new design is available to meet apparently serious design faults. The old boxes are too big, too heavy, and when they're worn out, the bottoms fall off.
It's a lot lighter than the existing metal ballot box. Closes simply, insert the tag here, this end, open the slot, and at the end of the day the slot is closed and the security tag is inserted like that.
But the man who designed them simply thought the traditional ones looked, well, traditional.
The boxes themselves were pretty antiquated. The design was, was easily improved upon, and the box showed its age.
1935, this one. Okay.
There are still some diehards. The South London Borough of Wandsworth is standing by the tin.
We were kitting ourselves out from new. We would definitely consider them. They're about half the price of the steel boxes. But I suspect they wouldn't come up to the same lifetime. And, of course, I don't know if they're plastic, whether they'd be biodegradable. That's another thing we have to think about these days when we're concerned about the environment.
But the really serious news is that the polling booth itself is under review. Apparently there's a triangular, flat-pack version available. And that's it from us. Back to you in the studio, Mike.
Thanks, Anne. The election campaign today has been focused on what's likely to be the biggest decision facing the next government, whoever wins, whether or not to join the European single currency. To join, countries will have to meet economic conditions that include stable inflation and interest rates. The single currency is due to start in 1999. On January the 1st, exchange rates will be fixed between member countries. By the 1st of January 2002, at the latest, euro banknotes and coins will be issued, and 6 months later, all existing national currencies will be withdrawn for good. Britain, of course, has the right to opt out of the single currency, and the Conservatives, Labour and Liberal Democrats have all promised a referendum on any decision to join. The Conservatives and Labour have both opted for a wait-and-see policy. The Conservative manifesto says the national interest is not served by exercising our option one way or the other before we have to, though it has ruled out early legislation. Labour's manifesto says there are formidable obstacles in the way of Britain being in the first wave, although it doesn't rule out membership then or subsequently. The Liberal Democrats stress the benefits of joining. They say being part of a successful single currency will bring low inflation and low interest rates. Our economics editor, Peter Jay, looks at the pros and cons.
It's hard to imagine a bigger gamble than the gamble on money itself. What kind of money to use? The gamble Britain faces on whether or not to join in Europe's single euro currency. If we stay out and the advocates of entry are right, then we risk missing out on and being left behind by the great machine of European prosperity and losing our influence and our place at the heart of European decision-making. If we join in and the sceptics are right, well then we risk undermining our competitiveness and so our jobs, as well as losing the power to manage our own economy. Britain has reserved the right to opt in or opt out of the new system when it starts. We're now going to test the rival odds of a gamble on going in, let's say red, or staying out, punting on black. First, we go for red. The Kent port of Dover. Since time immemorial, Britain's gateway to the continent. Trade and pleasure, businessmen and tourists, they all flow across the channel in a never-ending tide. That pattern is driven, paid for and measured by money, of one kind or another. Money, like cargoes, has to be secure. And that's why the euro currency will be managed by a new European Central Bank. A single currency will make money exchanges obsolete on ferries. But it will offer bankers a new job. They'll decide on the level of interest rates for the euro. The idea is that bankers, who don't have to be popular, will be more willing to put up interest rates to control inflation than politicians who have to get elected. In the longer run, a reputation for low inflation, as in modern Germany, can actually mean lower interest rates than in a country which followed a more inflationary path, as Britain did in the 70s and 80s. Inflation is one kind of heavy weather for business. Unpredictable exchange rates between currencies are another. Navico at Ramsgate make navigation equipment for small boats, exporting 80% abroad. Their profits go up and down like a yo-yo because of the daily changes in the exchange rate between the pound and other European currencies. This uncertainty would be removed at a stroke if Britain used the same currency as the rest.
No matter how good we are, if the currency speculators increase our price artificially by 25%, then we're going to have a doubly hard job. Our job is hard enough, developing new product, developing new technologies, investing in people, in training, in new machinery and new processes. What we need is a stable environment.
And then there's the question, what will the neighbours think, specifically the Japanese and the other high-performing Asian tiger economies who have poured more investment into Britain than into the rest of Europe put together? If Britain didn't join EMU, the new currency, would they just shrug it off, or would they cut off new investment, fearing that Britain would be isolated from the great EU marketplace?
I think it will reduce Britain's attractiveness a little bit. Whether it has a really damaging effect would turn on whether or not Britain remains in the EU as opposed to EMU, and what exactly the level of the pound was relative to the euro.
So that's the case for going in, for betting on red. The case for staying out rests on two arguments. First, that locking together the exchange rate between currencies in a single currency risks undermining the vital mechanism of British competitiveness, and so jobs. And secondly, that it takes away the power of economic self-government, the Chancellor's ability to set interest rates the exchange rate, and the budget. So, let's test the odds on staying out. Betting on black. These boxes were designed in America for a Japanese company, are manufactured in Dover, and are bound for Austria. The company which makes them, London Fancy Box, believes that a single currency would add to their costs and make it more difficult for them to compete in such a global market. Their concern is simple. Time and again in British history, pay and prices have risen in a way which make British exports too expensive for people overseas and make imports more attractive. The British economy becomes uncompetitive, industry runs down, investment goes elsewhere, jobs disappear. This problem can be solved so long as Britain has its own currency by altering the exchange rate between the pound and other currencies by devaluing the pound. That makes the boxes cheaper again and makes the British economy competitive once more, as happened after the pound left the European exchange rate mechanism in 1992. The company chairman fears that the euro will impose extra costs on British producers and make Britain less able to compete.
The risk is that we will get ever more regulation on top of what we already have, that our costs, which are already uncompetitive in many cases on a world scene, will become even worse.
Britain has always been captain of its own ship, running its own economy and managing its money, interest rates and the like. If the controls were taken away, the government in London could no longer try to steer the economy between the perils of boom and bust, of inflation and recession. And what's more, a nation's control of its own currency has always been a part of national independence and self-government. Indeed, history is clear that currencies have everywhere coincided with sovereignty and nationhood, and one without the other has never worked.
I don't think you can join a currency union, and I don't think that you should want to join a currency union, unless one is prepared to accept that a great degree of sovereignty goes with that, and it goes beyond just currency union, if that currency union is to succeed.
And there is one more hazard to worry about. Now people travel because they want to, for business and pleasure. But migration could become less voluntary if Britain in the single currency found it so hard to compete that, despite language barriers, workers had to seek jobs abroad. The decision whether or not to accept the euro, and with it the European Central Bank, is probably the most important economic choice Britain has ever made. If we go in, it'll be irrevocable. And if we stay out, it may soon become so. If we make the wrong choice, then both our economic and our political futures may be blighted, not just for years, but for decades and perhaps centuries. The key questions are two. Is the convenience to business and to travellers of using the euro and not having to switch money at the border worth more than the balancing function of the exchange rate between different currencies? And is it possible to have a successful currency without pooling more sovereignty than we want?
Peter Jay, and you can find out more details about the party's policies on Europe in our election fact file on page 130 of CFAX after this bulletin. The main election headline again. The Prime Minister has defended Angela Browning, the junior agriculture minister, accused of repudiating the government's line on the single currency. In an election leaflet, Mrs. Browning said she was opposed to transferring any British gold and currency reserves to the new European Central Bank. Well, joining me now is the BBC's political editor, Robin Oakley. Robin, what sort of week have the Conservatives had first? They seem to have been picking away at individual issues like unions, privatisation, devolution. Have they made any dents in Labour?
Well, it's been a bit of a mixed week for the Conservatives. They had all the problems of the sleaze revival at the beginning of the week, the intervention of Martin Bell, the re-selection of Neil Hamilton, which is probably not to the Prime Minister's convenience. Then, through the week, they started to score some points from Labour as they've got onto the detail of issues like the unions and privatisation, things like that, because Labour are under scrutiny from the media in a way that the Tories have been for a long time as the government. Now, in an election, that happens to Labour as well. Such movement movement as there's been in the polls has been in the Tories' favour, and they'll be pretty pleased with the way they've handled the single currency controversy today. Mr Major was on very good form at the Tory press conference.
Labour's basic strategy seems to have been defensive, not to take any risks with what appears to be this big lead that the polls show them having. But is that strategy itself risky?
Well, indeed. And Lord Jenkins compared Tony Blair's position to that of a man carrying a sort of elaborate crystal vase along a long and slippery corridor with this big lead he's gone into the polls with. Labour have looked a little bit uptight once or twice because I think they're so nervous of anything chipping away at that lead. But they must feel pretty comfortable that we've gone through another week of the election campaign, no very serious movement in the polls. They've still got that lead there, and they've been able to concentrate on positive things like their business manifesto, while the government are having to look a little more ungainly attacking them.
And the Lib Dems, they've been trying to be above it all, haven't they? Being rather lofty, not getting their hands dirty with the great political battle. Have they succeeded in doing that, and is it doing them any good?
Yeah, I think the Liberal Democrats will feel rather frustrated because they keep trying to get the agenda onto their issues. They're doing rather well in terms of putting the focus on health and education and pensions and practicalities like that, bread and butter issues, not looking obsessed with voting systems and so on like they did at the last election. But it's very difficult for them to get the rest of the media to talk about the things they want to talk about on the day. But they're quite pleased that they've had some good local government election results this week, which they say show their true position and not the rather low position they've got in the opinion polls.
Well, Oakley, thanks very much. And that's the news tonight. Newsnight on BBC Two at 10:35. We'll have a special programme in which a studio audience of voters will be putting their questions to the Liberal Democrats' deputy leader, Alan Beath. But that's all from the 9 o'clock news. Good night.
Now the latest from the southeast. Fire has devastated a square kilometre of grassland at Guildford in Surrey. More than 60 firefighters spent at least 4 hours tackling the blaze at Stringer's Common. The fire service says the cause of the blaze was arson. It's close to a site where road protesters have built tree houses, trying to stop widening of the A320. At the height of the blaze, firefighters were drafted in from neighbouring Hampshire. An investigation is underway tonight into the death of a man in an explosion at a gas cylinder factory. Hundreds of homes had to be evacuated for several hours following the blast at the British Oxygen plant in Merton, South London. Sarah Harris reports.
The explosion blew off whole sections of the roof at the oxygen bottling factory BOC Gases on the Merton Business Park. Many members of staff in the unit opposite were already at work when the explosion happened at just after 9 o'clock this morning.
We heard a big bang within the company itself, and all the windows and everything shook within the company itself. And we came straight up and looked out over here, and we could see that on the third roof panel in, there was a great ball of smoke coming from that area. And after a few minutes, we noticed there was lots of flames coming from there as well.
People living within a half a mile radius of the factory were then moved from their homes by the police, and the area was sealed off.
We were evacuated out, really. Initially as a temporary thing, but we've been here, what, an hour and a half, nearly 2 hours now. So we're just waiting to find out what's happening now.
Although the fire was put out quickly, experts wanted to be sure the heat would not set off further explosions. Two injured members of staff were taken to hospital, but have since been released. Just before lunchtime, the police confirmed another person had died. The BOC worker has not been named, but managers said safety procedures were in place.
What happens in that area is people are filling cylinders of gas. Mixtures, these are gas mixtures that are mixed very, very precisely. The main possibility with the compressed gas going to a cylinder, you can get an explosion from that because you've got gas under pressure. And of course, it may well have been a flammable gas in this instance.
Nearby roads and train services to Wimbledon were disrupted for much of the day, but things are now almost back to normal. It's still not known tonight exactly what caused the explosion, although a health and safety executive investigation is now underway. Sarah Harris, Newsroom South East, Merton.
The hot weather is causing misery for millions of people with hay fever. Unseasonally high temperatures are making trees and flowers bloom earlier than usual. Nearly a quarter of the population suffers from some form of hay fever, and an allergy helpline has been inundated with calls from people seeking advice. Amanda Harper reports.
Oilseed rape is now a familiar crop in our countryside. It's bright
and it's attractive. But for one in five of us, it spells big trouble. The hay fever season has come early this year, and for sufferers, that means reaching for the antihistamines.
Basking in the sun has become a feature of one of the driest and hottest springs on record. As temperatures in the region soared this week, so millions of hay fever sufferers, myself included, were plunged into early misery. Flowers, trees and crops, which normally bloom in May, are already open.
Do you know that you're definitely allergic? Have you been allergy tested?
A telephone helpline run by the British Allergy Foundation in southeast London has taken thousands of calls.
What we're seeing is people actually having really quite acute symptoms, and some people who perhaps might never have had really overt hay fever before actually having hay fever now.
20% of the population suffer from hay fever. An estimated 400,000 working days a year are lost to it.
It's horrible. Everything itches, it's swollen. I mean, the symptoms are actually often overwhelming. And of course, for people who have exams to sit, I mean, it's hell.
I went to one of the leading allergy clinics at the Royal Brompton Hospital in Chelsea for a skin test.
A mixture of grass pollens. We're going to go to the tree pollens now.
Most hay fever sufferers can have their symptoms under control for most of the season. Now, there will be certain individuals who, despite nasal sprays and antihistamines, are still very miserable. And in those individuals, we will consider other forms of treatment, of which desensitization is one.
If the dry weather continues, hay fever sufferers can look forward to an uncomfortable 5 months. The best they can hope for is a heavy downpour of rain. Amanda Harper, Newsroom South East, Hertfordshire.
Hope your weekend is sneeze-free. More news and sport from the South East tomorrow afternoon.
Good evening. Yesterday we had a taste of summer in the south, top temperatures getting into the low 20s. But today, a rude reminder that it is still only April. Generally, temperatures 5 to 10 degrees lower and a decidedly chilly feel to things down the eastern side. But it will warm up over the weekend. It should be pretty good for the London Marathon on Sunday. In the sun, temperatures getting up to 16 Celsius, 61 Fahrenheit, quite low humidities. So I think perhaps the runners might need to take on quite a bit of water and quite strong sunshine. So spectators beware, it is strong this sun and you could get pink in about 40 or 50 minutes. But back to today, and here's the weather front that brought the cold air around our area of high pressure. That weather front has just about disappeared now. The skies are clearing across the United Kingdom, and it is going to be quite a chilly night underneath those clear skies. A widespread frost and temperatures perhaps a couple of degrees below freezing in parts of the Midlands. The high pressure staying with us throughout the weekend. These weather fronts just grazing the far north of the British Isles, so that's where there's going to be a little bit more in the way of cloud. Perhaps a little bit of drizzly rain out in the Hebrides, northern mainland Scotland, up in Orkney and Shetland. But the rest of us will see some sunshine with top temperatures on Saturday around about 14 or 15 degrees, a little bit up on today's. Another chilly night, Saturday night, certainly a lot of ground frost around for gardeners and growers, perhaps even an air frost, that means air temperatures below freezing in central parts of the country. But then again on Sunday, quite a bit of sunshine around, any mist and fog soon disappearing in the morning, but once again it's that far northern part of the British Isles which we'll see more in the way of cloud and perhaps a little bit of drizzly rain, with top temperatures on Sunday a little bit higher than Saturday's at 16 or 17 Celsius. And another change for Sunday, because the London Marathon will be on BBC One, the weather for the week ahead starring Suzanne Charlton will be on BBC Two at 11:45 in the morning. Bye-bye.
In 1947, a £10 note could buy you a new life in a faraway land. Over a million Britons embraced that dream.
I said, this is the place, and I was so glad it was.
Yet the reality was often harsh.
I don't think it could say that Australia destroyed my mother.
I said, where's the toilet? And he says, there's a Chevrolet, and you can pick your own tree.
My mother let Australia do it.
I told her so there was no way out.
Stories of the £10 Poms, Monday, 10:30 on BBC One.
This is BBC One. Our party election broadcast by the Liberal Democrats.
Oh, yes, it is.
Oh, no, it isn't.
I promised I'll really do it.
I promise. Oh, when I do it,
it'll be like this under the Tories.
No, it'll be like
this
under the Tories.
No, no, we'll do it first.
No, we'll do it first.
No,
Same old story. Already this election has shown the Tories at their worst and Labour following them. They attack each other endlessly. They make all kinds of promises they know they can't keep. But if they stopped shouting and started listening, they'd see that people want something different.
Many schools are now facing meltdown. The young people of this country have enormous potential. But that potential will not be realised unless they can have a good education now.
There's not enough nurses who have time to talk to patients and to listen to them.
We're now controlling 53 councils in this country. That's more than the Conservatives. It's an incredible record in a very short time.
People want something different in education.
The Lib Dems have always believed in listening to people. Over the last 5 or 6 years, I've been to literally hundreds of town meetings to give people the chance to talk to me directly and to give me the chance to answer directly.
Even as a new teacher, I came in with a lot of enthusiasm and now I feel very demoralised.
The curriculum is changing more rapidly than ever before, and therefore there's a need for more expenditure on books.
Kids are going home to do homework without books to do it with.
Certain sets take the books home some days and others take the books home other days.
Anybody else? Marion?
I'm really angry about this because the Conservatives are cutting back on our future.
We'll make life better!
Decent education is the only way we can give our children chances in the future and our country success in the future. I'll tell you what I want to see. By the year 2000, by the new millennium, every child in Britain will have access to 2 years high-quality preschool education. And in the next 10 years, I want Britain to have the best schools, the best books, the best equipment, and the best teachers in the world. So that's why we say we'll commit £2 billion now, and that means asking you to put a penny on income tax. We're prepared to do exactly that. It's that important.
People want something different in the health service.
The only thing I can't understand is there's such a lot of problems in hospitals, but they still keep closing the hospitals.
Have they closed one near to you recently?
Yes, a couple of them.
Tell us about wards.
We've got people piling up in casualty.
That there isn't the nursing care to look after?
No. So you're cutting corners.
Bureaucracy too much?
You've got more bureaucrats, you're using up the money, so there are no resources to deploy.
We'll make life better!
Help! We'll make life better!
The NHS is in crisis. It's being underfunded and it's being undermined by too much bureaucracy. So we'll do three things. We'll strip out the bureaucracy where it's possible, and we'll invest that money in patient care. Secondly, we'll close the loophole used to duck national insurance taxation, and we'll use that to invest in more nurses and more doctors. And thirdly, we'll restore free eye and dental checkups as the start of a move towards prevention, not just cure. We'll pay for that by putting 5p on a packet of cigarettes.
Liberal Democrats make a real difference for local people.
How can the Liberal Democrats get more people involved in politics?
I'd like to see us at Westminster do the same kind of thing as we've done at local government level. Put people first. Make sure that they know what kind of services we can deliver. Make sure that they have a say. And above all, make sure that politicians listen a little more.
Liberal Democrats give people something different.
Only the Liberal Democrats will invest in education. Only the Liberal Democrats will invest in the health service too. Solve the crisis of underfunding. Only the Liberal Democrats are determined that we'll get more police onto the beat. Only the Liberal Democrats want to stop this Punch and Judy show that we've seen for too long and make Parliament listen. And that's why the Liberal Democrats will make the difference.
Tired of the same old politics? If you want to make a difference, support the Liberal Democrats. That was a party election broadcast by the Liberal Democrats, and it'll be shown again with subtitles on BBC Two tonight at 10:30.